don't get to go on tour. You don't get to go to France and all over the world and South Africa and everywhere else. They make it happen. So I had an interesting conversation with somebody yesterday at a brunch, and they're like, you know, when you blow up, you're not going to be this accessible. And I'm like, well, you could arguably say, you know, I've seen a scenario of having millions of dollars in the account. I've flown privately. I've been nominated for, you know, international awards and domestic awards. It ain't gonna happen. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm just, I understand I am a regular guy, and that's just who I am.
Yeah, I mean, it's really, and this is a conversation, because we talk to a lot of different bands, and this is a conversation I have with Amanda a lot. Every musician we talk to, every musician we bring in here, they're good at their craft. They're good at writing songs. They're good at what they do. You got to do something different. And what excites me about you is you are doing something different. You're taking your music and making it a lifestyle. I mean, when I talk to you, and when I talked to you before, and I've told you this before, and I know you probably think this sounds kind of goofy, but you remind me of Gene Simmons.
Which one? Dan.
I have the Gene Simmons.
Oh, you got it.
But you remind me of him. Because he says the same thing, be good at your craft, but you know, that's not all there is. You gotta think of the brand and the branding, and just talking to you just reminds me of his books that I've read. You know, I prepared a bunch of questions for you, but after meeting you, like I said, I wanted to throw them out, but I feel like I have to ask you some of these goofy questions that for you, and Amanda, jump right in if you want.
Uh-oh.
Now, I know your most recent CD of just Marcus Johnson was a rock CD.
Mm-hmm.
What made you decide to, because I know you're jazz influenced and stuff. What made you decide to do a rock and roll CD?
Well, believe it or not, the first band I was in when I first started playing at Springbrook was a rock band. So I was playing like Jump and Stevie Ray Vaughan and things like that in the beginning. Now, growing up in DC, you immediately end up going into the go-go kind of phase of things like that as well. In the church.
Pork and beans, isn't that the big go-go song?
Chug, I mean, yeah, exactly.
Sardines,
yeah,
and pork and beans.
Exactly, right? Junkyard band back in the day.
I remember that well.
And, so one of the things that always amazed me was, you know, when my mom picked me up from school, we'd always turn on, you know, Wash FM. And at that time, it was more of classic rock, which, you know, it's even more classic rock right now. So we turn on the station, and I'd hear tunes like, you know, Steve Miller Band, you know, Fly Like an Eagle, and which I, to this day, one of the reasons why I've recorded it is because it's one of my favorite tunes in the entire world. I can put that thing on and listen to it forever and ever and ever. You know, the Beatles Come Together, the meaning behind that. Then you
which,
know,
by the way, I wanted to ask you a Beatles trivia song, which has to do with a trivia question, which has to do with keyboards.
I'll tell you, I don't know it.
You don't know? Come on, you're gonna know it. Who is the, now the Beatles, as you may or may not know, always had a bunch of musicians.
Who's the fifth Beatle?
Hold on.
Okay.
They always had a bunch of uncredited musicians playing on their albums. Who's the only person to be credited, not a Beatle, on a Beatles album?
Billy Preston.
I knew you'd know it.
Yeah.
What song?
Oh, shit.
Now, he played on a bunch. but do you know what song?
I don't.
For bonus points?
I don't know.
Get Back.
Okay.
Yeah, the fifth Beatle. Okay. I knew you'd know it.
Okay.
The keyboard player.
Yeah, exactly.
Do you like his stuff, Billy Preston?
Was incredible.
Yeah.
I got a chance to meet him. He played on...
Yeah, great.
He played on an organ track on a guy I produced by the name of Jared, saxophonist from this area. When I did his first CD, Billy played on it.
And you got to meet him.
Yeah,
awesome.
Incredible.
Great,
man.
Great piano
player.
The Beatles, to have him named on one of their albums, you know they had a great amount of respect for him.
Definitely.
I got to ask, and I'm going to turn it over to Amanda because I know she has questions about your music, but I got to ask you, why Nirvana smells like Teen Spirit?
Why not, man? Come on, dude. I mean, it's like the first time I heard that song was, you know, mid-90s and everything like that, and it's the chord progression for me. I hear things in harmony, and it was just a groove, and then it was like, it's like, hey, we are ready to party.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? We are out here, entertain us, player. And you know, that's really what the hip hop movement, the go-go movement, jazz movement, that's what it's all about. And you know, to see Nirvana, Kurt Cobain, the whole crew, have 90,000 people at a stadium, know the words to the tune, and just go friggin' crazy, you know, it was that, there was something there.
Mm-hmm.
So. When it was really funny because when I introduce it, when I play, like everybody was like, how in the world are you going to do a jazz version of Smells Like Teen Spirit? And I always say, well, here you go.
I've heard it.
Come check it out. I was going to say, it's such a draw because you look at this, and you see Jazz, and you look on the back, and you see Smells Like Teen Spirit, and I thought, oh no, he didn't. You know, now I have to listen. How did he do it? Yeah. And so, very impressive.
So you've then, you know, I think we'll probably have some Police and The Cure and Pink Floyd on Volume 2. Because again, here's, again, branding, right? Yeah. This is how I rock, Volume 2. I mean, everything I do.
Maybe a Kiss song?
Hey, maybe.
I
was trying to figure out. There are a couple of Nine Inch Nails songs that I really like that I'm trying to figure out. I would have to change them so much that they may lose their identity. But, you know, there's some, you know, Aerosmith, a couple things there we could throw in.
Cool. Mandy, do you have any questions you want to ask him about his music?
Well, you know, I am a lady and I love my jewels. And I know you recently did a promotion that was quite interesting. You switched it up with David Yurman. Tell me a little bit about that. I know it was hugely successful.
Yes, we did something with the Real DC, Real Housewife of DC, Mary Amons, and her foundation with David Yurman to celebrate the release of Flow Chill Volume 2. Mm-hmm. I was on tour last year and I went to Paris and I met a young DJ who's a big time producer over there. And I'm a Rotarian, so his father's the head of the Paris Rotary, and we all connected. So he's been working with me now for 4 months in the States, and we put this CD out. So I was at a wedding, and the boutique manager for the Tyson's David Yurman store was there. And I was like, okay, well look, we have this new release. What about letting us come in? It's just me and a DJ, maybe a percussion player, and we'll do it. And you know, the people in New York, they're like, oh my God, they're not playing, are they? You know, who's Marcus Johnson? You know, the CD has Kate Moss. I mean, the flyer had Kate Moss mm-hmm. on one side and Marcus Johnson on the other. Mm-hmm. Like, everybody doesn't know who Kate Moss is in my community. And it was a great learning experience for both of us. It affirmed some of the things that I was pushing. And then for them, it was a learning experience because in an hour and a half on a very busy traffic in Tyson's Corner Tuesday night, mm-hmm. we sold $50,000 worth of David Yurman jewelry, you know, wow. in an hour and a half. And, you know, then everybody was like, okay, so my question was, on a regular Tuesday, what do you sell? Mm-hmm. $2,500, maybe if we're lucky,
wow.
like $5,000. So for me, so I just did your numbers by mm-hmm. 10, and these were my people. So from there, once again, as we said earlier, okay, we did this, now what can we mm-hmm. do? So the vice president of marketing came down and we're talking the possibility of doing a lot more stuff together. And out of it, I got my nice little dog tag mm-hmm. that they gave me. And just the validation though, when people saw it, and you can go to Facebook, and if you put Marcus Johnson and David Yurman, it'll pop up and they have the video and it's me, Young Pulse, and our percussion player names, and that's how we kind of do it.
Very good. Yeah. So interesting. That's a lot of money.
Yeah.
But you had their ears after that.
I mean, definitely.
That's all part
of it. And who's to say we can't have a flow line of David Yurman? Mm-hmm. And or, you know, hey, if they don't get it, that doesn't mean it doesn't work. Mm-hmm. That just means we end up going to another jeweler and saying, hey, look, why don't we have a flow line here? Mm-hmm. I mean, when the one thing that I'll tell everybody is, we were kind of discussing it before, the idea of failure. And failure is nothing but part of the process, which when you can internalize that and say like, it is absolutely guaranteed that you will fail at something. It is absolutely guaranteed that you will make mistakes. The issue is how you bounce back from them. And when you can internalize the fact that your failures are part of the process, you just shrug it off and then you go, because you say like, that's just part of the process. Oops, my bad, sorry. Oops, my bad. Mm-hmm. You're like a running back. I'm going this way, but the hole's there. Boom, touchdown. Right. It's the people that say, oh my God, you know, the hole closed here. I'm giving mm-hmm. up. You can mm-hmm. tackle me. I'm done. It's over. Woe be me. You know, woe be unto me. I'm not going
to
make it.
Right. You have to thrive through that discomfort,
yes.
right? And just keep on going, because nobody's born great at everything. You weren't born a great piano player.
Exactly.
You weren't born a businessman, so you have to...
I was born great at a few things, but I'm not going to brag.
Hey,
I was born with great hair, but you know.
I hear you. No doubt about it.
But I'm interrupting, please.
No. Leave it to Dave to lighten the mood.
Hey. And you have to do that. And that's another thing. Just have fun out here. But understand you will fail. Get back up, dust yourself off, take another step. Mm-hmm. You know, that's how you score a touchdown, you know? And that's really it. The sports analogies, life analogies, everything like that. Just keep on going. Mm-hmm. Have faith. And you put faith with works. I'm working on a book, and it's called The Pell, Dream, Plan, Execute, Listen, and Learn. And, you know, once you have the dream, then you execute it, man, you plan it, then you listen and learn, and then the cycle starts all over mm-hmm. again. If you remember that and that's all a process, nothing in the world you can't do. So David Yerman, I hope you all work with me, but if not, I will have my joy.
You heard him.
Well, is there anything, we're getting ready to wrap up. I mean, you're such a fascinating, exciting guy. I'm so upset we only have 30 minutes with you. Hopefully you'll come back and talk to us again
and we're
doing more shows. Because, I mean, there's just so much we can talk to you about, but is there anything now that we're wrapping up in particular, you want to push or plug or anything you want to pump right now?
You know, we have a couple of, well, not we, we have a couple, we have a ton of national hits going on and performances. The new Marcus Johnson CDs, we're still selling everything that we have here. We're on iTunes. Hit me on Facebook. I'm available. Doing a lot more public speaking. And
by the way, do you know what your number one song is on iTunes?
Urban Trust.
Yep.
Yeah,
I looked it up. Yeah. And by the way, that Beatles song is "Get Back." If I didn't say it earlier,
yeah, the one that
Billy Preston played.
Yeah. And the one on my CD happens to be "Come Together." So.
Right.
Yeah. So yeah, man. I mean, and the main thing is just everybody out there, just keep the faith. Have fun. You know, turn your BlackBerry and your phone off at 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock when you go to sleep.
You know, Phil does that. Yeah. Our producer.
Yeah.
Yeah. He does do that. He tries to get me to do that. I can't do it.
But the thing about it is, man, life is not in this phone. Use it as a tool. It's not a crutch, man.
That's what Phil tells me every day. He is my inspiration. Yeah. but I'm telling you, man, you've just been a really exciting guy to talk to. I wish we could have taped our whole segment when we did the pre-interview. I mean, that was great. Amanda, anything before we get going that you want to ask Marcus that we didn't touch on? I mean, I know we didn't have a lot of time.
Sure. And like he was saying, I would love to talk to you again. It's just been wonderful getting to know you, and thank you so much for being on Front Row. We'll have to set something up in the future. I don't have any last questions, I don't think, but Dave, take it away.
To check Marcus out, go to the Facebook, the MySpace. He's at threekeys.com. He's at MYPPK.com. He's at MarcusJohnsonMusic.com. He's on the iTunes. He's got 29 entries on the iTunes. Am I right about that, 29 entries?
Yeah, and if you Google Marcus Johnson, I'm the first one that comes up.
And if you use the Google button, you know I'm a big fan of the Google button, you can find Marcus Johnson. I guess we're ready to wrap up. Once again, I'm David Bayne for Amanda Mitchell, and we'll see you in the front row. Thanks for watching.